You can't just download stuff off the internet and throw it into your model. You actually have to think through these things. We're actually starting to see a lot of users model less, but actually manage more data.
Josh, there was something that you brought up in your part of the presentation where you were really kind of talking about LOD and the development of the model and the constructability model. Can you talk a little bit about, from that perspective, how we're looking at mirroring together BIM and the field and what information is important to carry through?
So there is an LOD. There's a level of development standard. There's the AGC BIM form, and then there's the AIE. It's something that we can turn to in our contracts and define level of development, which is critical for understanding the accuracy of the models and what we're expecting from all the contributors. You know, we go back talking to the team, and from that team aspect, we have to help the mechanical contractor, structural, architecture understand what level of development we expect at what time so that we can start to build that trust around the models. So the last thing we want is for someone to come in there and not trust what they're seeing in the models and get that feedback.
That is the secret to success. It's defining it clearly. No matter which country you're in, we've got the BIM protocol that's an addendum to the contract to make sure that it's actually enforced. We have the employer's information requirements that dictates what you are going to need to deliver at what LOD before you actually even get appointed. So those kind of things are just so important. And what I think we found is the successful projects are those that have considered this. And they've not left it to the end where actually they realized, oh, the contractor was expecting something totally different. And what we were expecting was to deliver this. You know, those conversations need to be had and agreed and, in an ideal world, contracted at the start of the project.
And your execution plan isn't a one-time done document.
Absolutely.
No.
It's got to be living. You have to bring it to your meetings. Some sort of course correction needs to be made. You go back to the document, you say, okay, what's missing in here? Now we're talking about clash detection. Do we have our search sets? Do we have our process of how we're going to be clashing? Now that we're talking about data exchange from an asset side, well, how are we doing that? What tools are we going to be using to integrate that? I think it has to be a living document just like the rest of the documents that you're working with, and you have to use it. It has to be a tool just like any other tool in the project.
It really helps for people who are new to this, to people who are coming in the first time and thinking it's a lot overwhelming. If they've got what we call the model production delivery table, If they've got the matrix of responsibilities and which LOD they're going to be working towards, helps them realize that they don't have to do everything. It used to be, you remember the old the curves that, you know, BIM brought all the design to the front end, you know, to make people realize that's not what has to happen. What has to happen is you have to understand what data is going to be produced when, and actually, just as you said earlier, just produce that, nothing more, nothing less. It takes a lot of the fear away.
And don't overmodel.
I mean, that's even more important, isn't it?
There's a point of file management that I think we finally have an understanding of. When a file is too large, or when a family in a model is too large, I think we're starting to be able to talk at a higher level, which means you can't just download stuff off the internet and throw it into your model. You actually have to think through these things. We're actually starting to see a lot of users model less, but actually manage more data. Because at the beginning of equipment planning, for example, I just need to know how big is the box so that I can space plan the size of the room. I don't actually have to know the equipment that's actually going in there and the nozzle and how long the cord is that's attached to that piece of equipment. So when they know that they can model less because they know why they're using that model, at some point you want to start upgrading those parts and pieces where it makes sense. And to me, people don't realize that these documents are intended to be helpful guides.
Exactly.
They're meant to be
resources
that you use throughout the project, not just at the beginning of the day and you bury it. But some people come onto the project team much later and they don't know what decisions were made, and they say, actually, I was hired as the curtain wall manufacturer, so I'm probably going to be modeling at 500, and everyone's like, what? No, because I'm fabricating off of my model. Do you want to use any of this?
It's a byproduct of what I'm already doing.
Exactly. So it's a useful tool only if you use it.